ready to make some music? Good, because we are. Everybody loves listening to music, but some of us just cannot live without it because we were born to make beautiful melodies and rockin' beats. This episode of Creative Kids is all about the music world's next generation. Times have changed in the music industry, and now, more than ever, your career is in your hands.
So what kind of music will you make? What instruments will you perfect? Being a successful artist or band means many hours of practice, practice, practice. And how will you use technology to make your music and build your career?
I would love to know what life as a pop star is like with all the touring and the glamorous life. And what's the best way to promote yourself to get really noticed? That all sounds really great, guys. And we also need to find out about selling our music, getting played on radio, and getting a record deal. Plus, we've got loads of other great information. Well then, it's time to make some music and get this show on the road. Electronic music, pop, rock, classical, composing music for film. Firstly, what kind of music will you make?
There are so many different genres out there, and you have free creative license to draw inspiration from any and all of them.
What kind of artist would you like to be? A lead or solo singer? A one-person band or an acoustic act? A pop synth group or orchestra band? An opera singer? Musical theatre star?
Okay, Penny, we get it. There is a lot of choices.
Forget record companies and forget trying to get a manager and an agent. When you're starting out, I would strongly encourage you to develop an audience. Ultimately, regardless of genre, whether you're Celine Dion, Marilyn Manson, or, you know, The Living End, it all boils down to your songs and how good your songs are. So I would strongly suggest if you're going to be an original act, songs, songs, songs. And once you've got the songs down pat, then you make sure you've got an incredible, compelling live show. So people like me and people like me in the business are going to be interested. So songs on songs, develop a live show, develop your social media presence, those three in that order.
Inspiration is where any creativity begins. Maybe it's the music you listen to when you're growing up or the unusual sounds found in world music.
My favourite singer is probably Robert Plant, and I love like Aretha Franklin, I love a lot of soul singers. Yeah, I think Led Zeppelin's probably our favourite band that we look up to, because they're just great songs and they're all individually great musicians that kind of make this magical thing.
Merging genres is actually quite common practice, so it's worth listening to more than just the modern top 10 charts.
And go out and explore life, meet new people and see new places. Also, surrounding yourself with art has a funny way of bringing up your emotional memory and imagination.
If you want to be a musician, there's a musician who has a skill. So whether that be playing an instrument or, you know, programming on a computer or whatever it might be, I think essentially you are spending time doing that and enjoying doing it. If you enjoy doing it and you spend a lot of time doing it, you'll get good at it. Networking is essential in this industry. You know, the more people you meet, the more introductions you have, the more you'll be sort of out there, and people will be hearing your name and really keen to hear what you're doing, and that sort of thing will help you your band get gigs. Being very savvy, or as savvy as you can be on the internet, with
right.
You know, keeping up to speed with the different technologies and social medias and all those sort of things, I think is crucial these days.
I've got a few questions to ask you as an up-and-coming pop star. How long is a basic pop song?
A basic pop song is around 3 to 4 minutes, which is how long you need to be played on radio.
Right, and then I guess, like on Gautier's album, you can make songs that are a minute long,
yeah.
Or Triple J told us that you can make songs that are even over 6 minutes long and they'll still play them. I guess that's just a commercial standard.
Yeah.
Right.
Definitely.
And can you tell us what the basic structure of a pop song is?
The basic structure is there's two verses, two pre-choruses, around 3 to 4 choruses, and then you have an alternate verse, which is like a bridge.
Right.
But the most important part is the hook, which is the bit in the song that gets caught in your head and you cannot stop singing. Like the bit in my song that people tell me is the hook is, yeah, yeah, yeah. That bit. You'll hear it. And you'll be singing all day, every day in the car and everywhere. And that's what you need to get in people's heads. What about the basic chord structure?
The basic chord structure is around an F, a C, a D, and a B. But that's just, yeah.
And so that would be in a major chord for a happy chord?
I think it's a sharp for B. It's a B sharp and then, yeah.
And then like a minor chord if you've got a sadder song.
Yeah.
That's just to get you started.
Mm-hmm. Normally it's just us four in the shed and somebody will have a little riff or a lyrical idea or something and we kind of just jam it out and normally a song comes out of it. So, yeah.
So then someone will start playing and someone will come in with something else, with
idea. Normally it's just one little idea that everybody goes from there and chucks in their little part of it.
Yeah, cool. How do you know when a song is finished?
There's no end to a song. When you give up on a song, that's the point when it's finished. Essentially, it's just it's a piece of art that you basically can no longer change or, you know, improve upon or, you know, can see any improvement from any further changes. It's probably the point at which I step back from a song and say, I think it's finished. It's just basically when any other changes you're doing to it aren't really
necessary.
Yeah, aren't really evolving it in any great direction, so therefore it's sort of time to just to let it be what it is.
Like other arts, music is often a collaboration. For example, you might have a composer or a producer working with a musical act to create the sound.
For example, you could be like Elton John. Like you could be an amazing singer, so you might collaborate with a lyricist.
But where can I find people to collaborate with?
Everywhere. Like amongst your family, think Good Charlotte Brothers, Benji and Joel Madden. Or amongst your school, like what happened with Dan Reynolds and Andrew Tolman. From the band Imagine Dragons, they attended university together.
Or if you attend music lessons with someone, like Penny and I, we attend music lessons together. So you could find someone there, or you could ask your teacher if someone's looking to be in a band or be a session musician.
A session musician is basically a hired gun. Someone that artists and managers can call on. It could be, you know, a last minute gig, it could be a last minute tour, that sort of thing. Or it could be just to, you know, play with another band or an artist or something like that.
You could also check out people online and see if you can find gigs and band members that way. You might even end up collaborating with someone overseas through like SoundCloud.
Some of the useful websites are StarNow, MySpace and SoundCloud. We'll be posting more on our website.
And, you know, don't feel like you have to hire the best singer or guitar player because that's exactly what band practice is for. It's more important that you really love the same kind of music and that you all get along together.
Make sure you get a secret practice place, somewhere where paparazzi photographers will not find you. Remember, everyone has to be committed to band practice, otherwise you won't get very far. And if you are committed, just think you'll get to perform live and even be in the recording studio recording your own album.
Lastly, when collaborating or in a band, it's important that you sit down and write up an agreement that applies to everyone. This agreement should cover how each member of the band can use the name of the band, who owns the songs, how expenses are paid for, how payment works, and what happens if the band disbands or someone leaves it.
Yeah, this is really important, and you can find band contract templates online. It can really help save misunderstandings later down the track where bands can often break up because of disagreements.
Let's take a look at the engineering process of making music, which means how to make a good quality recording.
How to do it yourself at home.
If you're recording your demo at home, make sure you're in a room that has little or no background noise. Example, a cupboard.
Yeah, and a carpeted room is the perfect place for you to be recording direct sound, which is when you put the microphone exactly in front of the source. However, if you are going for something like an echoey reverb effect, recording in a tiled bathroom is the perfect place, and then you can add that effect in inside the mix.
So Sam, why does a carpeted room sound different to a bathroom when you film?
It's very much to do with what the surfaces in the room are made out of. Bathrooms generally have shiny, hard walls made of tiles, and things that water can't obviously get into. So they're very reflective, they're very echoey. The sound can literally hit the wall and bounce off and hit another wall and bounce and bounce and bounce around. And that's so why cool. It doesn't die down, it just keeps bouncing. So that's where you get the echoes or the reverb. In a carpeted room, obviously, if you go into a carpeted room that's got carpet on the walls and the floor and the ceiling and you scream, as soon as you stop screaming, sound goes nowhere. It's absorbed by the surfaces. Okay.
You can play live, so all the instruments are recorded on one track, or you can use multi-track recording, where each instrument is recorded on its own track. This gives you more flexibility when it comes to mixing your music.
Good quality sound begins with quality recording, which means you've got to go and learn some miking up techniques. Perfect place to do this is from demonstrations on YouTube.
Then you're ready and you can mix and master your record. This means changing the sound levels, adding cool effects, and making sure that the whole album is perfect.
A lot of artists will choose to record at home because it's just more comfortable and they can do it at their own pace and there's no financial pressure, you know, paying for a studio and all those sort of things. So experimenting and mucking around with computers, I mean, it's the technology what you can do at home these days is, you know, it's amazing. So if you're just playing around with it and experimenting with it, you're getting familiar with a studio essentially, and so that when you come to actually perform in a proper studio, you know, and the expectations there, you'll be a little bit more prepared, I think. Generally there is a lot of work to be done, and if they're getting, you know, getting involved and guiding the project a little bit more and in the way that they want, then you're going to get a better result.
A record deal is on the wish list of many musicians, but how do you actually get one?
Well, some great tips are to create your online profiles and make some videos, post them online, share them online, get some followers and get likes. If you get enough likes, I tell you what, record labels are going to take notice of you. Our city started this way.
Go out and play live gigs. Just like there are scouts online, there are scouts and A&R people that go to see live gigs to find new talent.
Can you give us some tips on getting prepared for your first ever gig?
Yeah, sure. We see a lot of young people come through the band comp, young musicians and under 21. And so getting prepared for your first gig, I think the first thing is really practice your craft. It's an obvious one, but you know, stay in the garage and get your craft, your songwriting, your performance, get that all down to a T before you hit the stage. That's the first thing. The second thing in the band's career is just in terms of your networks, like really go out and play shows with like-minded bands and build a network around you and support the scene. And then thirdly, I guess just to think about the business aspect, and when you're ready to play shows and record and put a product out and be ready to sort of service radio, if that's what you're going for, to get a single on the radio, that can come further down your career pathway. But the crux of it is to really practice your craft. We assist bands in all areas of their career development. So sometimes a band could be just getting from the garage to the stage, or if they're further down the track, we could be assisting them with their bio, their press kit, their photo shoot, through to presenting music to radio. So that occasionally happens. We see a lot of bands come through who get to play at a national festival, for example, as well, which is another milestone that bands often strive for.
If you have an idol, example Katy Perry, I'm going to give you a hot tip. Go to the back of her CD, find her booking agent, send them some of your music, and then bam, you could be supporting Katy Perry on her next tour.
Every time you record a song that you're happy with, send it in to Triple J's Unearth. You guys just find the new talent in Australia, don't you? That's what you guys are about?
Yeah, that's what we're about. And thankfully, with Unearth, the new talent comes to us. It's a website, triplejunearth.com, where people, musicians, bands, hip-hop artists, anybody who's making music on an independent scale, if you're independent or unsigned, you can upload your music to triplejunearth.com. It's basically a tool online for any artist, however, you know, young or old they might be, to upload their music online and have it listened to and rated by not only Triple J staff, but thousands of users who use the site every day.
What are the do's and don'ts of pitching to Triple J?
The big do is to
make sure you listen to Triple J, what, you know, music we're playing, figure out where, you know, you would fit best across the station. Service your music to us just by either a CD or a digital delivery. You know, obviously nowadays, MP3s, SoundClouds, all the Dropboxes, everything like that. You don't need to have a, you know, a professionally pressed CD with a fancy cover. You can just send us a press release via an email with a link to a download or a link to a stream on Triple J Unearthed or something like that. And that can be, you know, the easiest and the best way to service music to us. A big don't, I always say, is don't feel like you need to tart up your package. You don't need to send it to us with a whole bunch of streamers and bells and whistles, glitter in the envelopes. Because really, it comes down to the strength of the song. So if you try and you don't need to hide it behind anything, just let the music shine out for itself.
Oh, how times have changed. It used to be that you just send in a demo of your best three songs and wait for a phone call. But obviously no one wants 300 CDs sitting around on their desk anymore. So all you have to do now is send in your digital links.
Record labels are also interested in how professional you are. And even if you're quirky, they're still looking for some commercial appeal.
Once you're lucky enough to secure a record deal, you head into a professional recording studio and you'll work with an awesome producer whose job is to take your music to the next level.
And if you're just getting started, there are smaller, more independent labels that deal with up-and-coming artists. Labels can generally help with things such as legal matters, organising tours, marketing and distribution.
In the arts, a lot of what you're dealing with is people's creative ideas. So, how do you own something that you can't feel or touch? Well, that's where intellectual property comes in. It's property, but it's property of the mind, if you like. It's about who owns the rights to do things. Not surprisingly, one of the key words when you're talking about the rights to do things is copyright.
Yeah.
Contracts are a really big thing, that relationship between people. So contracts, intellectual property, they're probably the two main things that you really need to understand from a legal side if you want to get into entertainment.
Let me assure you that a lot of labels, managers, and I do it too, I'm guilty of it, but I like to see what's happening online because that's a barometer. And it's real-time measuring of an artist's popularity. There's a site called Hype Machine, which I get a lot of information about. It's international, and it's an aggregator site. What they do is they measure an artist's success by the amount of blogs that are talking about them. So it's a pretty influential tool in this business right now. I look at Facebook, I look at Instagram, I look at websites, I go to a show, ultimately, you know, and see how good they are live.
This is a good time to begin thinking about your image. So, what will you look like? This will depend on what kind of message you're trying to send and who listens to your music.
Think about what makes you unique and start from there. And it may also help to wear leather and studded belts if you want to be a rock star.
Or bright colours and blue wigs if you want to be a pop star.
Get some promotional photos done. And make some videos to upload and share online.
Yeah, and if you want to be making your own videos, how about checking out the filmmaking episode of Creative Kids?
Once signed up on social media, no doubt you'll be inundated with fans.
Yeah, your poor postman's going to be totally weighed down with all the envelopes he has to deliver your house.
No, Lisa, that's what happened in the old days. But nowadays, most people use social media. Responding to fans is what helps them stay loyal.
Yeah, it's important to let them know that you just couldn't have done it without them and help share your success on your journey. And once you do become famous, you can always appoint one of your loyal fans to run your fan club.
Or maybe you can throw a special event just for those fans that follow you online.
We think that running our own social media is really important because it's a great way of being in contact with our fans. And yeah,
it's more special to the fans, I reckon, because like it's not.
It just feels really
more connected.
I think it feels really stale and false when record companies are running bands' social media. It's really out of touch, and I don't know. I just think that it's such a big part of especially young people's lives now. Yeah. most young people are on Facebook or on Instagram, Twitter, whatever. And I think for us, we like to see what bands have to say themselves, not, you know, the record company that's just posting to, you know, sell records or whatever.
Let's talk about touring. You're going to be away from home, so you're going to need money to cover your food, travel expenses, accommodation, and you're going to want your parents there so you can buy some things because, let's face it, they're the people that have the money.
Don't forget to leave with all your venue information printed out, like your contact details, your maps, and your venue's number, just in case of emergencies.
And like your mother would say, make sure you pack spares of everything because you don't want things breaking or things running out of battery and you can't replace it. So you've got to be really mindful of that.
And you're going to be traveling a lot, so it's best to take a laptop or an iPad to amuse yourself or maybe, you know, write some notes about the previous show and what you can improve on.
And have you thought about who's going to be mixing your shows? Some venues supply sound engineers, whereas some bands like to use their own. So you've got to really think about that.
How does a band find a sound engineer they want to work with?
Well, so if you're a new band and you had a manager, for instance, or your new band, you wouldn't know sound engineers. Your manager or you would generally try and find one. If you're a band that wanted somebody, say you wanted me to mix your band or something, then somebody would know somebody in the industry. They could ring somebody and say, I want Bruce Johnston to mix my band. And they'd say, oh, here's his number. And they'd find me that way. But if you're a new band, someone always knows somebody, but the management would generally find you a sound guy pretty quick. Or one of your friends in another band would know somebody. And that's how it starts, basically. Yeah. That's how you find a sound guy, because it's not like people advertise.
And when you're playing, don't exceed the allotted time. It's really unprofessional, and it may annoy other bands or the venue promoter who's in charge of scheduling.
You need everything in the right place. There's no point going overseas unless they already know who you are.
Yeah.
So a lot of the work is actually basically creating an online social media presence, getting some people in that territory or that country or that city interested in your music and maybe playing the songs on the radio, and then basically building those relationships. And the first thing you might do is send over the singer, or you might send over the manager to actually go and build some relationships before the band comes over. And when the band comes over, you've got to have a lot of shows. You don't just go over for the one show. So basically, Sounds Australia give really good advice about when you're ready. And it's a term called export ready. When are you export ready? Like, have you played enough here? You know, play around Australia, play in little country towns, get to the stage where your act is so good that it's as good as it can possibly be at that stage in your career. And then you can get advice from them about when you're ready to go over, and then they'll help set you up over there.
Yeah. That's cool.
And consider recording your performances too, just to put on YouTube for those fans that couldn't make it. And they can share it with their friends as well.
And remember, when you're on tour, you're also networking. So be sure to be friendly and professional when doing gigs.
Wow, there is so much involved in making music.
Yeah, I never knew you had to think about all these things.
Yep, if you are serious about becoming a musical artist, don't let the haters stop you from doing your thing. Yeah, but you do have to work hard if you want to reach the stars. Practice makes perfect.
Yeah, and you don't have to wait till you finish school to begin your career. You can start learning an instrument or singing lessons now. You can do it. We know you've got plenty of talent hidden away.
Yeah, and you don't have to wait till you get signed to begin selling your music either. If you need any more information, just go to the Kids Corner on the Far Out Films page. And there you will find the list of links that we think are awesome. That's right. And we hope that you are now a lot more motivated and inspired to be on your way to winning your first Grammy. There's only one more thing that you have to think about, really, and that's what will you be calling your band? Bye! Bye.